Let me start by showing you my three, you could say, laws that I have discovered in the past 25 years. There is no energy crisis. And why is there no energy crisis? Because we have an energy system that is only efficient for 2% of energy efficiency, only 2%. We are wasting 98% of our energy. And we'll give you some examples to show you how inefficient our system is. And the second one, you know probably, but the sun gives us in 1 hour more energy than that we consume in the whole world in a whole year. So why do we bother? But that's because of the third one. Renewable energy has an advantage. It is everywhere. You have the sun, the heat in this building, the wind blowing outside. But it is not as condensed as a barrel of oil that you can travel around the world and can use where you want to have it. You have to yield, you have to grab the energy where it is. And that means that we have to develop another type of system than that we have today. We have to think differently about that in the energy system. And I will tell you some things about that aspect, how to think different and what is going on in that respect. But first, the energy efficiency in the world. I will give you some examples, and one of them is the doorbell that we have in our homes and houses everywhere. And what do you do when you have a doorbell in your house? You have a transformer, an inverter in your house, and that is always looking to you, to the doorbell, to when somebody pushes it, it gets on. But you need a lot of nasty kids or friends, of course, to push that doorbell knob for 1 hour a year. And all the time, that transformer, that inverter is on, dissipating some energy. 5 to 10 watts you're dissipating in that doorbell. So on average, you could say a doorbell uses 50 kilowatt hours a year. And then you do some calculations. And you see, hey, we have in the European Union 200 million doorbells times 50 kilowatt hours. That means that we are spending 10 billion kilowatt hours on our doorbell. And the efficiency, that's only that 1 hour that we use the doorbell, divided by 8,760. So much less than 1%. So 10 billion kilowatt hours we are wasting on our doorbell. And that doorbell, as I said, we are using only for 1 hour. That means that we are having 2 600-megawatt power plants running all the time to produce the electricity for our doorbells that we are wasting. That's what we are doing in our system. And then, can you do this in a different way? Can you develop another way of making this happen? Of course, we could do this by producing that electricity with a large solar panel on our roof. But is that the way to go? No, it isn't, because if you place such a solar cell on the doorbell knob and it gives some energy, and you store it in a capacitor and you use it at the moment that somebody pushes the bell to shut on the inverter, then it is not producing that 50 kilowatt hours, it is saving that 50 kilowatt hours. But the device gives you a little bit energy at the front of your door to run that doorbell. And that's the way, in a nutshell, to develop our energy system much more. Now, I will give you some other examples, because you think the doorbell, that's an old-fashioned thing. But look to our internet router. Our internet routers in our house or offices uses about 18 watts when they are running, when they are transferring data. But they are using 12 to 15 watts in standby modus. And that's not necessary, because you can make a device for 10 euro cents, which shut down, it's even lower, and then you're using 1 watt in standby, having the same performance. But again, if we say that we use the internet routers for half of our time, so half of our time it is in standby, then we save, or then we spend another 10 billion kilowatt hours idle, losses on our internet routers. Another 2 coal-fired power plants of 600 megawatts, you could say. And it is easy to avoid that standby losses of this internet routers. That's what we are doing at the time. And that's where my book is, the title of my book is coming about boiling an egg. What are you doing when you boil an egg? You put a pot on the stove and you throw some water in it, and then you have a fire or do it electrically, but you heat the water and then you do in the eggs, and then you boil the eggs in 5 minutes to a soft boiled egg. But all the energy is in the water. And what is the energy that you're throwing away again afterwards? The efficiency of this system is less than 1%, because you're boiling water instead of the egg. We have tried to do this in a microwave. I cannot recommend it because it explodes, of course, because it is uneven heating the egg. But there are technologies now coming that you can do that in a special microwave to boil your egg in 1 minute. It's even faster. Eh? And you're saving a lot of energy, because you're saving the energy that you put in the water. You could do it also in another way. You have your sink. If you have a second pipe in your sink, a heat exchanger, then you can try to get out the heat from that water that you throw away and store it in your boiler that you have in your sink. But you see, we are doing a lot of things. We have in mind that we are doing it because it is like this, but it is a very inefficient way to do. Then our car. What do you think that the efficiency of bringing you from A to B with a car is? Now, we are going to make some calculations. We have our engine of the car that has on average an efficiency of 15 to 20%. But then we have to bring that turning movement to our wheels. Then we lose a factor of 2 again. So then we are about 7 to 8% efficient. Then we have all kinds of losses because of the resistance, the aerodynamic resistance, and then we are at 3 to 4%. That's what we normally hear that the efficiency of our car is. But then the worst part comes. We are moving ahead 1,000 kilo of a car to move myself 100 kilo, a little bit too thick, I know, to another place. That's a factor of 10. We are moving 1,100 kilo, well, we only have to move 100 kilo. So that's how we can, and that's why we are much lower than 1% in our efficiency of our driving, of our cars. Now, I've said a lot about this, and you can have a lot of examples, and you read in my book some more of these examples, but the energy efficiency is very low. And we have to redefine, re-engineer all these processes to have much higher efficiencies. But now the second one, that is looking at, that is the sun that gives us in 1 hour more energy than on the earth than that we consume in the world. You see, we receive from the sun 5,450,000 exajoule. Exa is 10 to the power of 18. So you see, we are using about 535 exajoule a year, and this is a factor of 10,000. That is, you could say, the 8,760 hours a year. But what are we doing with this energy of the sun? 34% is reflected back into the atmosphere. 42% is heating up the land and the water. 22% is in the water cycle. That means the evaporation of water out of the oceans going to the land, and then it is coming down. That's where the hydropower comes from. And here you see 1% is going into wind. And wind is the uneven heating of the Earth's atmosphere. And we have here some atmosphere, some air that we heat up. Then the hot air is going up. And there you have a low pressure field. And the cold air, that is the high pressure field. And wind is nothing else than that we have to move some air from the high pressure to the low pressure field. So that's 1%. In the photosynthesis, the biomass, we have only 0.23%. And a very small part of that is stored in the ground in oil, coal, gas, because that was in the early days the photosynthesis. And even this is a very large part of our energy. But you see, the sun gives us not only direct heat or the sun irradiation, but it gives us also the wind, the hydropower, the biomass. All are derived from the energy from the sun. There are only two other sources of renewable energy, and that's the geothermal heat. That is, of course, the earth core heat that is going up and coming to the earth. And the other one is the tidal energy, that is the attraction, the gravity of the earth and the moon, that gives you the tidal energy. Are also large sources, but the sun is, of course, by far the largest source of energy that we have on the earth. Now, this is more or less what I told you before. You see here that we have the light which you can convert to electricity by photovoltaic cells. You see here also the photosynthesis process, where we produce food, where we have waste from that food production by animals, for example, the dung. But also here you see that we have fossilized, and that's the crude oil, the gas, the coal that is coming out of the photosynthesis. We can use it in a direct way for heating, cooking, or for solar heaters, but of course it is also heating up the atmosphere, making the whites, the winds, the tides, and also the waves, because the wind is blowing over the ocean and that gives you the waves. So an indirect form of solar is wind, and then the indirect form of wind is the waves, and therefore wave energy is also indirectly a form of solar energy. And here the hydropower, because it is the evaporation which gives you the falling down of the rain, and then you have the hydropower. So all these sources are derived from the solar energy. But now the third one, and that is the difficult one, because the energy is everywhere. Renewable energy is everywhere, but it is not as it is not condensed like a barrel of oil, as I said. And now we have to look and we have to think differently about our energy system if we want to make really a renewable energy system. But what is the traditional way of thinking? And that is reflected here by the energy chain. You see that what we normally do, we start from this side. We are looking into the ground to extract some energy from the ground. Oil, coal, gas, uranium, it's all in the ground. Then we treat it, then we put it in a tanker or in a pipeline or whatever, and we put it in our refinery or in an electricity power plant to make electricity or gasoline or whatever. We distribute that to a gasoline station or to our homes or to our offices, and then we put it into the tank or through a meter, and then the energy sector says, hey, we have done our job. But there it starts. There we have our car, there we have our light bulb, there we have our doorbell, there we are going to use it, and there we have our waste. It is after the meter, as the energy sector says, but for a consumer it is before the meter, and that's also the strange way of thinking about the energy system. And what do we have to do if we want to develop a more efficient and renewable energy system? We have to think the other way around. We have to start from the energy surface, because we don't care about energy. We want to have a warm or a cold house. We want to have a soft-boiled egg. We want to have to bring our kids to the school. That's what we really want, but we don't want energy. We want the energy services. And that's the way that we have to develop our system in a much more, in a much different way, thinking not from the extraction to the energy service, but the other way around. So we don't want to stop with the energy meter or the tank or whatever. We want to start with the energy services at the office buildings that we want to cool down or to heat up. That's what we really want to do. Now, I will give you some examples how you could develop these systems and also what the trends are in this sector to see that there is really a lot of this happening. But before I will give you the first things, I want you to show you this one. This is, you could say, the statistics in a little bit different way about our energy use in the world. And it is divided in four quarters, you could say. And we use about 25% of our energy for heating and cooling buildings. We use about 25% of our energy for the transport, to move around our products, but ourselves also. We use about, say, 25% of our energy to produce electricity. And we use about 25% of our energy to make products out of it. That's the feedstock to make from gas, for example, a fertilizer or plastics or whatever, from oil, and for the high temperature steam. And this is another way of putting it. You normally have these energy balances of a system, and then you have this, several sectors, etc. But if you look to this, then you see also the functions that we are doing with energy. And these are more or less separate systems that you have. The transport sector is using mainly oil, and you're using a refinery to produce gasoline and some other products that you use in the transport sector. The electricity sector is using oil, coal, gas, burn it in a power plant and then produce electricity. And for example, heating and cooling is done very differently in different countries. For example, in the Netherlands we use gas, but in the UK you use a lot of electricity for it. Now, you see, it is a different type of system, but it is not interconnected. And you will see in the future there will be much more of an interconnection between these four systems, you could say. Now, as I said, let me give you some examples how you could develop another type of energy system and going into some trends. I will start with the renewable energy integration in some products, energy producing buildings, say some words about the lighting system, the smart DC grid, offshore renewable energy, electric transport, and our car as a power plant at the end. But let's start with renewable energy in products. What we see today is that we have the trend of mobile and wireless energy use in our computers, in our mobile phones, everywhere, even in our screwdrivers. That's everywhere we want to use not a wire to connect it to a plug, but we want to use it in our hands everywhere that is possible. So storage has become a very important aspect of having your mobile phone and using it for a long time. But renewable energy, because it is very dispersed, you can use it everywhere, can have a very useful function to produce the energy for our wireless mobile applications. And there you see that we have two technologies, you could say. The one is the solar, the photovoltaic system, where we produce from the sunlight some electricity that we can store in our batteries. But the other is piezoelectricity. If you push on a material which is piezoelectric, you produce some electricity. So you can make a computer with under your keys with some piezoelectricity and produce energy out of it. And if you work very hard and make your courses very good, then you don't have to put on your computer on the electricity grid. Only when you work very hard, because it's not possible to do it only with piezoelectric. But you see at this moment that there are a lot of applications with solar energy. One of the first one was the buoyances. Normally you have to travel to such a buoyance with a ship to replace the batteries. And with this system, with solar, you don't have to do that. And that is of course a large advantage, not only because the technology is expensive, you could say, at that early days, 20, 30 years ago, but it was less expensive than to travel every month to that buoyance to remove the batteries over there. But you see here a pond with a solar, but you see also the for the solar for the LED lights on the, on your bike or on your scooter or whatever. And you see here a lot of machines for parking where we do this. And that's also much easier because normally you have to dig for a cable, and the cable costs you €100 per meter when you want to do that. And when you have to go under a road, it's almost impossible to do that. So you see there is a lot of advantages to use solar with all these machines. Here you see a grass mower, which is working by itself. It's working all the time because we have a wire around your grass, and there it moves around. You don't have to, but you see it here on boats, even the Toyota Prius, you can buy with a solar roof, which has an advantage that when it is hot outside, and you don't have to turn on your engine, and you can air conditioning your car. So you see, and this is only the beginning of this, you see a lot of these applications starting with solar in it. But piezo is also interesting. You have here piezoelectric material, for example rubber, and the tires of your car are piezoelectric. When they go driving around, and they produce a little bit of electricity. And you know that because sometimes you have that static energy, and you get a shock when you. But here you see, for example, rubber, a chip that you can build in a pacemaker. I myself have a pacemaker, and I have to go to surgery every 7-8 years because they have to change my battery. And this is working on the pulse of your heart, and it produces enough energy to run your pacemaker. You see here even that they have nanotechnology, that hairs of nanotechnology, so when you shout a lot in your mobile phone, you can produce electricity and store it in your batteries. And you're laughing, but it is really the case that you can make all kinds of equipment where there is movement, with this material, and you will see this a lot. We have, for example, in the Netherlands, I've not taken that movie, but we have the sustainable dance floor, and that's piezoelectric material in the dance floor producing the electricity for our boxes, the sound that you have, and for the LED lights. So you have to really dance, otherwise you don't have music. That's the way we can use this material. Okay, so far about the wireless applications. You see, I start from the energy service itself, and then I'm looking how are you going to develop these technologies further with some renewable energy in it. And then you don't need to connect that to the grid, you could say. The second one is the energy producing buildings. If you look to our buildings, that's not here, because here you have to cool your building every hour of the day, you could say. But in Europe, but also in the United States, you have buildings that you have to warm up in the wintertime and cool down in the summertime. And that's strange because we use a lot of energy. As I said, 25% of the energy is going in heating and cooling buildings, to heat and cool our buildings. But really, in wintertime, it's cold. We want to heat up our buildings. And in summertime, it is hot and you want to cool down your buildings. This is not an energy problem. This is a storage problem. Because if you can store the heat from the summer and use it in the wintertime, and do the same thing around for the winter cold, store it and use it in the summertime, your problems are gone. You don't have to use any gas or electricity or whatever to heat up these buildings. So we have to develop not a more efficient boiler, we have to develop a heat and cold storage technology. Now, how could you do that? You see, for example, and that's all around in Germany, in the Netherlands, also in China, these systems of geothermal heat, what you are doing, you dig a hole in the ground about 100-120 meters deep. There you, in the summertime, you store the heat in een what we in the open system, that's an aquifer, hè, that is a, you have clay layers in the ground, in sand with water in it, and you store the heat in that sand with the water, and the clay layers, they say, hey, the heat will be there. It will, of course, a little bit going outside, but it is not much. It is a natural vessel, you could say, in the ground, a natural tank in the ground. In the winter, you do it that the other way around. And what are you going to do in the winter time? Then you pump up this heat, in the winter time, and it heats your buildings, and you do that the other way around. You have also the closed systems where you don't have these aquifers, but it is hotter in the ground. It is geothermal heat, you could say, and you store the heat underneath here. And then you use the temperature of the ground to heat up or cool down your system. You always use a technology, the heat pump, to pump it up at the right temperature. So you have to use a little bit of electricity to pump it to the right temperature, otherwise would be too good to be true, of course. Now, one of the systems, if you look to the Netherlands, we have a lot of greenhouses where we grow tomatoes, flowers, everything that you can grow over there. And these greenhouses uses a lot of gas in the wintertime. 10% of the energy, the gas consumption in the Netherlands is going to our greenhouses. But again, what is it? It's really, from glass, a solar collector. So in the summertime, there's so much heat coming in that greenhouse that we have to open the windows to get rid of all the heat. And all the energy is going out. But what is also going out, we are pumping some CO2, carbon dioxide, into these greenhouses to grow these plants faster. But when you open the window, then carbon dioxide is going out. Also, the water is evaporating through that open window. And we get a lot of insects inside that spread the diseases, so we have to use pesticides to get rid of all these diseases. And what have we done? We simply have done a heat exchanger, collect the heat, store it in the ground, as I showed you in the previous slide, and use that heat in the wintertime. And because we have this solar collector, it is collecting so much heat that we not only can heat the greenhouses, but we can also heat some houses, swimming pools, whatever, in the neighborhood. It is producing more heat than that we consume. And then we can close these windows. And what did we get? We have an increased crop production of 25% because the carbon dioxide is kept into the greenhouse. We don't use any pesticides, almost no pesticides. We reuse a lot of our irrigated water, because you collect it and you reuse it again, so we don't need a lot of water, which especially, for example, in these type of countries is important to have. And you have an improved process control. For example, you want to get your flowers ready before Valentine's Day and not after, because then they have less value. And you can, because you have a closed system, say, hey, we want to have our flowers ready before Valentine's Day. So you see, by using the principle, hey, it's not that we have to produce energy. No, it's a storage system. We have developed this system. And what did you get? You produce even more energy, low temperature energy, I have to say. But you have some other gains. You have an increase of 25% in production. That is the most important gain that the farmer can have, because that gives him really the money. As I said, in these areas we don't have heating and cooling, but we want to cool all year around our buildings. And if you see that around the equator, 50% of all the electricity is used for cooling buildings by air conditioning systems. You say, hey, what could we do there? How could we do that? Could we produce, because what are you doing when you have an air conditioning system? And with electricity, you produce cold water, pump it through a system, and then you cool down your buildings. We have developed in the Caribbean a system where we use the ocean in the ocean there we have the cold streams about 600, 700 meters deep. There the temperature of the water is 6 degrees. That's a natural source, a renewable energy source, because it is formed by on the poles and it is moving around in the oceans like this pattern. So you see here the cold ocean coming around the Caribbean, going this way around Australia, then heating up, coming up, and then you have the hot ocean streams. For example, here at Europe, we have the hot ocean streams, and there you have on the surface a hot temperature and a lower temperature, for example, here at the African, there you have a lower temperature at the ocean. But you can use, and I go back to my previous slide, you can use that simply that water that is there with 6 degrees temperature, bring it to the surface of the land, and then pump it through the system, and then pump it back into the ocean at the temperature where it is. Then it is still 12 degrees, and you pump it at 40, 50 meters deep where it is 12 degrees. You don't need a lot of pumping energy because you use the siphon working. Yeah? So this is lower than the ocean, and you suck once and then you put it in the, that was in the early days I have borrowed some gasoline from my neighbor, you could say, by using this trick. It's the same thing, so you don't use a lot of energy to pump it up. You need, of course, energy to pump it through the building, but it's the same energy that we use now, and you save 90% of the energy for using this system. When you have this, then you have a temperature of still 12 degrees that you pump back, but the ambient temperature is about 25, 30 degrees. What do you think that you can do more with this 12 degrees? And you can cool down the ground, for example. If you have a pipeline and you lay it under a golf court, then you cool down the ground. Then you cool down the air that is above that ground. And cold air can contain less water than hot air. So you don't need any irrigation system. You have produced fresh water. And for your golf cart, you can do it without any irrigation system, but only with this cold water temperature of 12 degrees. So you see, you can develop differently all kinds of systems by thinking to this same principles of, hey, where do I have a renewable source? It's really a renewable energy source. And how can I use that? How can I use that temperatures to produce energy or air conditioning, because we don't need energy, as I said, we want a cool building, and produce, for example, fresh water with these type of systems. What can you do more? When you have a temperature difference of, say, about 25 degrees, if you have a Rankine cycle, you can even produce electricity with it. They have only a 6 to 7% efficiency, but you can produce electricity out of the temperature difference of, say, 25 degrees. And these organic Rankine cycles, OTEC systems, you call it these days, ocean thermal energy, electricity conversion systems, we are going to develop, because you can use this resource not only for the air conditioning, because that's of course very important, but also to produce electricity around on these islands. And who do you think that is the most interested party to produce energy from the oceans? That is, of course, all our navy and all kinds of other companies, you could say, that want to produce at remote spots electricity, because you don't need a grid. You can produce it on the temperatures that you have in the ocean. Now you see, heating and cooling buildings, you don't need to so much energy for it, because normally in temperature zones where you have a winter and a summer, you can use storage technologies. And in areas where you only have to cool the buildings, you have to look around because I know for sure that you can go here also in the ocean to see where it is. For example, we have looked to Singapore, a city where they even cool their metro tubes. The metro is cooled, the metro tubes are cooled, but you can easily go 50 kilometers offshore, going with a big pipe into the ocean and use it for cooling these buildings. Hong Kong, it is sometimes used, more the surface water over there, but you see, it is coming, these type of systems.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
In this type of system, does the salinity of the water play a role?
No, because you haven't, of course, you cannot directly use it into your buildings, you don't want to do that. So,
yeah.
So and so you have a heat exchanger here, and of course it means that these systems are not the normal heat exchangers, but that is titanium or whatever material that you use, because otherwise it is rather corrosive and it will not last for maybe a couple of months, but then you have to replace the system. Of course, so you have to deal with this salinity, corrosive elements, but there are heat exchangers already, of course, that are in place where you have a high salinity, you can work with it. And of course, these are more expensive than the normal heat exchangers, but what do you need here? It is a pipe and a heat exchanger, normally. And the other way is that you have a chiller, a complex electricity you use to make cold water. It's really ridiculous that we do that, but that's the way we have invented it, and we are not thinking about it. I think I will introduce this, and then after the break I will go further with the, because another system that we have in today, that is our lighting system, and we use quite a lot of energy, because what do you think that the efficiency of our normal light bulbs was? It was only 2-3%, so we convert electricity into light with an efficiency of only 2-3%. The rest, we know, is heat. If you try to grab a light bulb, don't do that, because you burn your hand, and that's all the energy that is lost. But there is another aspect which is important to know. We have our lighting system normally in our ceiling. You have there the lighting system. We produce there most of the light, but we use it here. You could say you consume the light at your eyes. Of course you want to read also your papers, etc., so you need some light at your papers. But there, most of the light is. The distance is a very big energy loss, you could say. If we can bring the light closer to our eyes, to the subjects that we want to light, then we save a lot of energy. So it's not only the technology, it is also the system that we have to change. If you see that from all the electricity that we use, almost 15-20% in the world is going into the lighting system, we know that that is a big part of our energy consumption that we have. And therefore, you see that there is a lot of development in what is called clean light. And clean light is, of course, first of all, developing buildings that use the daylight, that have sensors that you can control, because there is always a lot of light on at moments that we are not in that room or not in that building. That is introduced also here. If you go to the toilet here, I have seen you have your sensors. So it's going on the moment that you are coming into that room. And you want to have efficient lighting systems. And what do you see today? We are going to the LED lighting system. And these LED lighting systems make it possible also to do that in a different way. I said clean light, the LED lights, that makes the technology much more efficient. That's the one thing. But LED is also a very small device. in that very small device we can use in a different way, because I said also the distance is one of the energy wastes that we have, and some of you already said, hey, but we don't want to have only the light around our eyes, we need to light also a little bit of the, but that's true, but you don't need to have the light there, and you don't need to have most of the light at the ceiling. And that's not what we want to have. We want to have a nice environment, and we have to do a lot of research if you want to do that in another way. Because with LED lights, because they are small, at this moment we are replacing the technologies. Eh? So we are replacing the LED lights over there. But we could easily bring in the LED lights over here. And we could easily do it over here, or have it down in your carpet, or have it at the wall, on a closer distance. But then again, we have to do a lot of design work, because if it is right in your eyes, it is not comfortable either. So we have to develop new types of systems. But integrating the LEDs into a lot of your devices, in your furniture, in your wall, in your carpet, that makes it not only the technology much more efficient, but also the system even more efficient. And what do you have? A LED is a diode. It's a smart element. You can control it. It can say something about it. It makes it possible to have an interactive system. For example, we have now a system, I don't see it over here, but when there is a fire, there are some signs that show you the way out. Yeah. If you have LED lights, it could easily show you the way out with the LED lights when there is a fire. You don't need that system, and it is even closer, because I can't see that system. And that's what you see over here. So if you make a design with a LED light system, you do not need to have it at the ceiling, but you integrate it everywhere. And if you see that the lifetime of a LED, which is about 30, 40, 50,000 hours that it can give light, that's of course much more than a light bulb, which is 1,000 hours. So you see that you can develop all kinds of different systems with these LED lights. And let me give you some examples. You see here the parking lots where we use a lot of lights at the airbase. And now it is still a light bulb here above it. You can do it also in the ground, for example. And here you have another problem with LEDs. It has an other spectrum. And you have in your eyes two types of things that you can see the light. And during the night, you use another type of the spectrum than that you use during the day. You see, these systems give you more a clear view than that it is than that you have with light bulbs, but it is not within the regulations, because the lumen, which is measured in a part of the spectrum, is not there. And still, you can have a better look. So you see, there is a lot of things, not only technological, but also all kinds of regulations that you have to change when you change also your system. Because also in your office buildings, you need to have a certain lumen everywhere, also in that corner. And that's what it describes, but it is not necessary. So we do not only have to change the technology, we have to change also regulations in this respect. Now, here you see that there are a lot of applications at the moment developing where we integrated lighting into everything. In your bathroom, in your you can create another atmosphere when you have a kitchen, for example, when you're cooking. It is the LED lights are bright and white, and when you want to have another atmosphere, you can create it by using the LED lights. And you can control them with every device that you have, also with your iPhone, with your smartphone. So you see, we will have and develop another type of system when we look to the LED lights. And you see, even you can integrate it in clothes, in your shoelaces, or in your jacket, or wherever. Outside, you can integrate it in your all kinds of pots or whatever you want to light. So you will see that there is a huge change in using LED lights. This is, by the way, it is a little bit dark, but it is a sustainable dance floor. They are not dancing too much here, you could say, see.
This is my favorite thing of the show. This is the Samsung Transparent Smart Window. So it looks like a normal screen, but I can actually do things like make this blinds. So I can close the blinds. I can actually see through to the little town outside. If I want to hit widget, I can check out Twitter. I can check the forecast for Vegas. This is so freaking cool. This is future technology right here. It's a one-sided pane, which means people can't walk by your kitchen window and see what you're looking at, so you don't have to worry about that. I know that it's going into the coming months, their mass production in the coming months, so we're gonna start seeing stuff like this ASAP, and I'm pretty excited about it because, well, quite frankly, I feel like I'm in Minority Report, and that's really awesome.
Okay, what you see here is a smart window of Samsung. It's OLED, which is in there. It can be also your lighting system if you want. But you see that there is integration of functions, that you, because LED is really also your television screen. That's what LED is. And so you can have a large wall where you have a cinema on it, when you have LED lights over there. It can show you pictures. You see, for example, also, not run the total picture, but this is South Korea, where they have dance battles. And they have a building where they project that on with the LED lights. And of course, this has nothing to do with energy efficiency, let me say it in this way, but it shows what you can do with this. They have some sensors on it. And they have battles between several groups in the city on the screen of one wall. You get the picture, eh? I don't think you like all this music. Maybe you do, but for the moment it is enough. You get the picture. You can use your LED lights as a large television screen, as a cinema, as whatever you want to do. And it makes your surrounding smart. For example, we are working on a system that you can collect all the data of a city in it. And now you are in a hotel somewhere where you don't know the way, and you want to go for a run, for a 10-kilometer run, but you don't know the way around. You have the LED lights in the ground, you have your smartphone, which gives you the place where you are, and the LED lights show you the way to go. It can move, it can show you also if you want to walk through a city where you have to go, you want to go to a restaurant or whatever, it shows you the way. That's what you can do with LED lights. That's what you see also, that the future element of such a LED can give you more than only the energy efficiency, also other energy services or services that you see developing at this time. Now another one. That's about the battle that we have had 150 years ago between Mr. Edison and Mr. Tesla. And that's about our electricity grid, because our electricity grid at the moment is AC, alternating current. And there was a battle at that time, I will show you first.
First there was Ben Franklin and his kite. Yeah. That was the beginning of our story with electricity. Then people fiddled about with it for a century before they started even thinking about wiring it to our homes. Then the question was, do we use alternating current, known as AC, or direct current, known as DC power? It sounds academic now, but it became a savage debate involving Edison, Westinghouse, and Tesla. In the end, alternating current won the debate, which was fine. After all, AC is good at carrying power over vast distances to run AC systems, like old-fashioned refrigerators or an old radio set. So things hummed along for another 100 years, right up until today. So you ask, now what's the problem? Well, like a lot of things that are 100 years old, the entire system has become terribly inefficient. These inefficiencies started to creep in around 50 years ago, when semiconductors were showing up in things. And while many electrically powered devices can use either DC or AC, semiconductors require DC power. What are semiconductors in? A lot of stuff. A whole lot of stuff. So, before these devices can use the AC power, they have to convert it to DC. And in that conversion, you actually lose power. A nice big chunk of it. Feel the heat from the back of your television or the brick on your computer? That's energy being wasted. Semiconductors are only one part of the problem. The other part of the problem involves the growing interest of converting power closer to home, with things like solar roof panels or plug-in hybrids connected to your house. And the way things are wired now, you have to convert them to AC power to get them inside your home or to your car, only to have to convert them to DC again. This takes the long way around when there is an opportunity to directly connect at higher efficiency. Confused? So is the grid. But all it really means is that you are losing double-digit percentages of power all over the place. So it sounds like DC power is the more efficient way to go. Why don't we just use that? Well, it's definitely a point worth exploring. If we were to optimize our systems to use DC power in a smarter way, create it at our building sites throughout the country, we could dramatically increase our energy efficiency. We could not only create our own energy, but also do more with it. It would change the future of energy. The good news is we can, and can start right now. Over the past decade, Nextech has developed, tested, and deployed their DC system here, here, and here. This has resulted in energy savings of 10 to 42% versus conventional practice. If we were to deploy the same method of energy creation and consumption across the entire United States, the saving would be enough to power the state of California. If this shift to smaller DC power systems, known as microgrids, starts to happen, it will have a dramatic effect on energy conservation today and in the way we create and consume energy over the next 100 years. And when you think about it this way, it seems less like a drastic change and more simply like the
Now, you get the idea, I think, from this picture. We have created an AC grid all around the world. And that was a nice story about that battle, because Mr. Edison, of course, was the guy that wants to have the DC grid, because he had the light bulb was working on DC. So he created the DC grid, and still in New York, till the 1998, there was a DC grid for the public lighting. And then they changed. Also the railways are still on DC. But the rest of our system is on AC. And at that time, Mr. Edison wants to promote his system, and he hired some people, marketing people, that go around with AC current to kill animals. To kill, for example, the elephant that has already killed two, that was broken out of the zoo, and that has killed two other people. And then he said, hey, see how dangerous AC is? And then there was a commission of the United States that came to him, and he said, could you develop the electric chair? He said, the only thing I want to do to develop this electric chair, then you have to take AC power, because it's very dangerous, and therefore our electric chair is on AC these days. You don't want to hear that maybe, but it's the story that you see that Mr. Edison, but he lost. And why have he lost? That was at that time, we didn't have the chip. We only have some appliances that were also running on AC, but Mr. Tesla, with also Mr. Westinghouse behind him, that was the large company that was building the power plants. The power plants have a turning turbine, X. And that was, you could directly feed that into the grid, because that was AC produced at 50 or 60 hertz in the United States. And it was more easy at that time to have a step up in voltage to a higher level with AC. And that was Mr. Tesla, he invented that. And therefore, because you have a lot of losses when you go on a low voltage throughout the country, because the losses is the current in the, to the power of two times the resistance. Now, the current is much higher when you have low voltage levels where you transport that on. So therefore, he won the battle at that time. But at this time, with our modern power electronics, it is not more difficult to have a step-up converter in the DC voltage levels with our MOSFETs, IGBTs, etc., to go to a higher level. So all the things have changed in that 150 years. And at this moment, our system is ridiculous, because this is what is happening. We have a DC source, for example, solar. We have to convert that into AC to feed it into the grid. Then we use it in one of our appliances, and all our appliances are working on DC. So in that appliances is a converter, which makes from AC DC, and we use it. And there are, in all these steps, losses. In a DC system, you don't have it. And if you're now going to think about a system where we have, for example, electric cars, where we want to store some of our electricity in the battery of that car, then it is even worse, because then, and you want to use it, then you store it in the battery of a car, then you want to go back again, so then you have again the step from DC to AC, and use it in your appliances, so then you have even 20, 25, 30% losses because of all that conversion steps. And there is another thing. You need a lot of copper to do all this conversion. And if you are going to think about a renewable energy system, where we have a lot of, say, small solar systems, wind turbines, all kinds of other small devices. And for example, our piezoelectric thing is also producing DC, you could say. And we cannot feed it into the grid if we have for every of these small appliances a DC AC converter to bring it in the grid. Try to calculate how much copper we need. And then you see that is a ridiculous amount of copper if you are going to change towards a system with only solar and wind, etc. Even a wind turbine, maybe you think, hey, a wind turbine, that is a turning movement. That's AC, you think, but it's not the right AC. Dus in every wind turbine we have an AC, DC, AC converter to get the right AC over there. And if you think about a solar cell and solar system, and nowadays we can buy from and install it for $1.50, $2 the system, 10% is now already the inverter. We can simply skip that or reduce that, because we need a little bit of a step-up converter over there. And we save in that system 10%. No other big power plant has to buy an inverter, because he can directly feed into the grid. But that is because of the stupidity of the grid and not because of the stupidity of the system that we want to connect our solar system. It's more expensive because we produce the right current with solar instead of having the current that we have from our power plants. So the idea is we have to change back towards a DC system. And we are doing that already. If we are going to connect, for example, a wind farm offshore, we bring the power to the shore with a DC, high voltage DC cable. And when we make connections from one country to another country through an ocean or a sea, then that is a DC connection already. When we want to do the desert tech, and then we make cables which are DC. And then onshore we are going to convert that again from DC to AC to feed it into the grid. There you see already on the high voltage level, we have already this development, but now on the low voltage level. And there you see that a lot of applications are being developed at this time on DC. This, for example, the data centers, where we have the cloud, where we have to build a lot of data centers. And all the big companies are doing that on DC. So they convert at the gate of that data center from AC to DC and then go into the data center with DC. And you see here the savings. It's about 10% energy saving. That's not so much, do you think, but we save 50% of the investments on the electrical part of that data center. And we save 1/3 on the space we need for a data center, because we do not need all these conversion steps and cooling steps at every device in that building. And that's bulky material. So you save a lot on the space that you need for that. Reliability is improved. You don't have reactive power, higher harmonics, etc. It's all gone. And that's why we see at that application we already have the DC. But also in our greenhouses, I'm from the Netherlands, so greenhouses are my favorite devices. We have a lot of light at the greenhouses to grow this, and also during the night we have light in the greenhouses to grow these plants much faster. Costing a lot of energy. And what I told already about the LEDs, we can of course change that LED lights, but then we have only the technology efficiency gain. Here you see that we bring the LED lights in between the plants, because it is a much smaller device. And we use only that part of the spectrum that these plants like. And so we don't, we can really only use the blue and the green and the red whenever they like that part of the spectrum as much. But we could not bring that in between the plants if we have in every of these LED lights also an AC DC conversion. You see here, this is the electronics that we use in each LED lights to go from AC to DC, and we can simply skip this part of all the electronics in every LED light if we feed it with DC directly. This is producing also the heat. If we skip this, do it only at the gate of such a greenhouse, then and have a DC grid in the greenhouse, then we can bring in the LED lights even in the plants. And then we save a lot. This system saves a factor of 10, a factor of 10 on energy, because you use LED and you bring it in between the plants with this LED lights and by using the DC grid inside. That's what we see today, and that are the systems that we are developing. So what I want to say, it's not only about the appliances that we have or all that kinds of energy services that we want to develop. As I showed before, the heating and cooling of buildings, the lighting system, the appliances that we have which we can feed with solar or with thing. This is about the grid. This is about the electricity grid. And that means also that at the end of the day, we want to use a DC grid in our houses. We want to use a DC grid in our offices. And we want to use a DC grid everywhere. And that needs a whole new development of this system control, the electronics that we need. And that's not a DC grid of 24 or 48 volts, but what a lot of people think, but it is on 400 volt, 380, 400 volt. And every appliances that we have today, we can simply stick in that DC grid, because it is transparent in the appliances, and we make DC in the appliance. And you can simply do that. Every appliance is working on a simple 380 DC grid. We have some safety problems. When you pull out a plug on a DC grid, what do you get? A nice arc. So that's not what you want. But that is simply that we have to develop another type of plug. Where we have also one pin which is a little bit short, and then you disconnect already, and that type of thing. So we have to do a lot, but it is not that we have to change our appliances. We can use the same appliances that we have, and therefore we see now that there is a lot of development also in the big companies like ABB, Siemens. They are having a department of DC since a couple of months. They see that there is a development in this direction. Let me tell you one story. We have in our house and homes and offices, we have a safety mechanism. If we connect a device which asks too much energy, then we have our fuses and the rest of our appliances don't work also. A stupid way of doing, because that appliance causes the problem, and the other things that works properly do work properly. If we are going to a DC system, then we have also another type of control. Every appliance or plug sends a signal to a router, and he says, hey, I'm coming on this grid, and my demand is so much of power that I want to have. Can I get that? And if the router says, hey, that's not possible, you don't switch on that. And that's, of course, in a millisecond we have done that. But then you do not need fuses, because there is no device that you couple to your system without any, you cannot damage it. It is another type of control system. And that's also what you see when you go to a DC grid, a whole different type of controlling the system. Interesting. I don't know if you have here a department of electrotechnical engineering, but ask them what they are doing about DC. Almost nothing, because the whole world is always thinking in AC terms. And there are professors enough that know a lot about AC, but there are, in, for example, in Delft, where we are rather famous also in the electrotechnical department, but there is no professor working on DC. We will get now one. Okay. We move on now to the topic of the production of energy, renewable energy. And one of my favorites is that we want to produce renewable energy, of course, locally, on one hand, but on a larger scale, offshore. And why do we want to develop our production offshore? Simply, we have a lot of space. The oceans and the seas are 70% of the total area of the Earth. But we have also better sources. We have stronger winds, we have seaweed, algae you can produce, we have waves, we have tidal energy, we have solar, of course, and therefore we have simply much more renewable energy offshore than that we have onshore. And we have space. To explain, for example, algae or seaweed, you have an 5 to 10 times as much biomass production by algae and seaweed than onshore crops. And why is that? Such an algae or seaweed is only green. It's only chloroform. There is no stems or roots which consume energy, not producing energy. Therefore, you have in algae and seaweed much more biomass production per hectare than that you have on onshore crops. So you see, in every respect, solar maybe not, because that is the irradiation, but the winds, the biomass, and you have other sources that you don't have onshore, waves, tidal, that's what we have offshore. And therefore, I say, hey, we have to go to our offshore development of renewable energy. To give you also an example how powerful and how much potential this has. For example, this is the North Sea, the UK, the Netherlands, Germany, Denmark, Norway, France. If you want to produce all the electricity with wind farms offshore in the North Sea, you need so much space. 6% of the North Sea, which is a small sea, to produce all the electricity of Norway, Denmark, Germany, the Netherlands, Belgium, France, and the UK. And this 6% is every kilometer you have one wind turbine. You do not occupy, you do not have a whole large area of solar panels where you cannot do anything with the surface anymore. Now you have on every kilometer in this area a wind turbine. So you see that you don't need so much space to produce all the electricity that you want in this area. As I said already, I have built the Princess Amalia wind park, one of the first offshore wind farms in the Netherlands. 60 turbines of 2 megawatt at that time, V80s from Vestas, producing a capacity of 120 megawatt, producing 435 million kilowatt hours every year. And it has an area occupied of 14 square kilometer. We are running now for 5 years. This is the most constant, predictable source of energy. Every year we are within 1 or 2% of the predictions that we have done for that year. For 5 years in a row. And we have built another one, the Belwind project is in Belgium, a wind farm, even larger. Running for 2 years, it's within 1 or 2% that you can see what the average yearly production of wind is. Much better than conventional power plants. Because we predict, of course, also that a wind turbine could be out of order. But we have 60 wind turbines, we don't have one plant. So we have a more statistical approach, which is much better than when you have a large power plant. A small impression how of the building of that, the construction of that wind farm already 5 years ago. You see also how big these machines are. That's also the impression that you see. You see there is a lot of space available. And when you see what is happening over there, we are looking at that area. We are growing, for example, on the pole of one of the wind turbine's muscles. Because there you can do that. There is a lot of fish now in that area because the fishermen cannot go around with their large nets because they are not allowed and it's too narrow to do that. So you see there the sea life is going to increase. That's also the same with, for example, our oil or gas platform that we have. Under that platform we have the best fish population that there is in the ocean. And that's also what you see when we have our offshore situation. But what are we thinking for? We are thinking about technologies to use, for example, also the waves in the tidal, the current that we have in the ocean, to produce electricity also. We can do that with one generator if we couple it in this way. And that's what we are trying to develop now as a technology. First, of course, standalone, because it's difficult enough to control all the forces that we have on this poles. But this is what you can do if you have a wind turbine. As I said already, seaweed, that's one of the biggest resources, and also per hectare we can grow a lot of, we have a lot more, and it is around in the world. Let's see, for example, you maybe not see what it is, but this is the Saragossa Sea, near the Caribbean. There's an area of about 1,000 kilometer in this direction and 3,000 kilometer in this direction. It's about 3 million square kilometer, 3 to 4 million square kilometer. And that is what we call, this is not a dead ocean, but we call part of the ocean the dead oceans, because there is a strong current in that ocean that pushes all things aside. And therefore we have these oceans where there is plastic and the birds are flying there, picking the plastic, and they die because there is no fish, or there is not, it is an ocean desert, that they call. That's not the case in the Sargasso Sea. There we have the sargassum, and that's this material that is a seaweed that clicks in each other. And therefore it is like a blanket on this ocean. We have, this is 1/3 of the area of the United States, for example, this sea. We can easily produce, with all this biomass that is here, the energy that we want to have for our transport sector. It is there. It's growing in 5 weeks. When you put it away, in 5 weeks you have the same amount of biomass again. So all the discussions about using it for food or whatever, we have to look to the oceans to see what there is. Here it is. We don't have to plant it or to whatever we want to do. But also, what are we doing in the ocean at this moment? We have built that Princess Amalia wind farm in the North Sea. What we are trying to do there is a sea farm. We are making some connections in between these wind farms with some ropes, and we are growing seaweed on that ropes. And there we can produce also seaweed, not only for energy, because first of all you are going to use that for pharmaceuticals, for example, or for food. The Japanese eat a lot of seaweed. Or you can produce some energy out of it. Oil, because seaweed, you have millions of different types of seaweed, but if you give certain part of the algae and seaweed a thermal shock, as they call it, they produce a lot of oil, fat, immediately. And you can use it as an oil or fat that you can use for your tanks. But here you see also the connection with the wave and the tidal. And you see that you can make even floating wind turbines, because that's nothing else than having a weight under the sea. And of course you have some connections to the seabed, but there you can also building in deep water, of course, your wind turbines. And then you can produce a lot of electricity or energy with these wind, or with these ocean energy farms, as you can call them, in different ways. You can even combine that with, for example, depleted oil or gas fields, where you pump some carbon dioxide into the gas or oil fields to get an enhanced oil recovery, and put a power plant there, and then you can combine it with your fossil fuels that you have available maybe in that ocean. Make an electricity grid around it, and we don't need any power plants, any other things onshore, where we have a lot of pollution or whatever, and we produce all the electricity at the oceans. These are the technologies at the beginning of development. Let's be honest, such a seaweed farm, we are testing that on 100 to 200 meters now in the oceans. How do we collect also the seaweed, and how are we going to produce some oil or whatever out of this? That's also in their first phase of development, of course. You see here also the osmotic energy. Do you know what it is? You can produce energy out of fresh water streaming into the salt water, because there you have a potential difference. And if you are looking to all these rivers, for example the River Rhine in the Netherlands going into the North Sea, then in this potential energy, the salinity difference, the potential that you get from that, that's the same as that there was water flowing from a height from 120 meters down in a hydropower plant that has the same potential, you could say. Although we don't want to have these osmotic power plants in the River Rhine, because there are a lot of ships traveling around, and you don't want to do that. But look to a country like Bangladesh, which has a lot of rivers flowing in, a lot of flooding. They want to have dikes around at several places. You can make a pump, an osmotic pump, that can pump out the water to the ocean and at the same time produce electricity. Because you pump it out with 2 meters or 3 meters and you still have 100 or 110 meters. And do you think these plants are already there? They are. There are 100,000 of these plants. You call them reverse osmosis plants to produce fresh water from salt water. Every hotel in the Caribbean, and I don't know exactly here, has such a power plant. It's thinking the other way around. The technology is there. And of course, we have to develop a lot because it uses a lot of membrane and a lot of area. So it is not easy to do it, but this is really a renewable energy resource which is there. Which indirectly is of course also a form of solar energy, because it was the evaporation where the salt is staying in the ocean, which brings the water cycle again in the ocean by fresh water which is going into the ocean. Okay, then we go to the transport sector. And what you see today is that we are moving towards electric transport. And at first everybody is thinking about the car, but that electric transport is already underway, because all our forklifts has become electric, almost all our forklifts. We have golf carts, we have our bikes. Look to China, how many bikes you have which are electric. Almost all of them are electric. The scooters, some of the boats, the ferries, and now we are starting with the cars and the buses. But this is already a trend. The trend is there. But you need an infrastructure, the charging stations, slow and fast, battery changing stations, maybe inductive loading. But you see at this moment, it starts in the cars. Why? Not only because it is more energy efficient, but also because it gives less pollution in the cities. It doesn't give a lot of noise or fine dust or nitrogen oxides or whatever. And therefore, electric driving will have the future. And not only because of the energy efficiency part of it. You see, we have a lot of cars already on the market from the big car manufacturers also. And this is of course not a big car manufacturer, but Tesla. You see the name is coming from a famous scientist. Electric driving, sports car. Peugeot, Nissan, Mitsubishi, all large car manufacturers have that company. But we have two main disadvantages by driving an electric car when you do that with a battery on board, where you store the energy in. The distance that you can drive is not as large as that you want to have. And to charge a battery in your car, when you have a normal charger, it takes 8 hours. And when you have a fast charge, it still takes 10 to 15 minutes. Much too long to be very comfortable. You want to drive, if you talk to Mercedes, they say, hey, we don't want to have these electric cars because our Mercedes drivers, they want to drive 1,000 kilometers and not every 150 kilometers that they have to take a hotel to charge their car overnight. That's a ridiculous way of doing business with this transport. So, what do you see? You see a lot of hybrid cars. And these hybrid cars, they have an engine on board that produces, sometimes that you have two types. You have the parallel types, which they run directly, they drive directly. And then you have an electro engine and a normal engine. But you have also the serial connection where this electric, where this engine is producing electricity. You store it in the batteries. And then you drive your electric engine, which drives the wheels, you could say. This also has a better performance also in energy efficiency. Why? Because you can run your engine on the very efficient way and not that you have to go up and down and be and you save energy when you are standing still, etc. So, and you see now, you have Toyota plug-in hybrid is a parallel version, I have to say, but the Opel Ampera, Chevrolet Volt, these are the serial types of cars where you have a normal engine running on gasoline. Because as I told you before, that normal gas engine has only an efficiency of 50% to 20%, which is of course not as good as that we want to have. And therefore you see that all these car manufacturers at this moment are working on the fuel cell technology. A fuel cell is a chemical way of producing from a fuel electricity. It doesn't run, you don't have vibrations, it doesn't smell, it has no noise. It is a chemical way, it is like a battery, only the other way around. And you produce, here you see for example, I think it is a Honda car where you have the storage tank for the hydrogen, where you have your fuel cell stack, where you have a battery and your electrical engine which is running over there. With such a fuel cell, you produce with a 60% efficiency from hydrogen electricity. And you don't have any other byproducts that you do not like. If you look to the development of the fuel cell technology, you see here the figures, and we want to have a reduction in costs to about this is $30 per kilowatt you want to achieve. We are almost there, that's not the problem, but we have another problem, and that's the lifetime. We want to drive 200,000 kilometers with a fuel cell and not 75,000, because then you have to change your fuel cell after half your lifetime. And that's what we are not there. But this is really an engineering topic. There is much work done. It doesn't need a lot of new breakthroughs in technology. So there is a steady work going on the fuel cell development. For example, Mercedes has 3,000 engineers working on the development of the fuel cell, and Hyundai, Mitsubishi, all these companies have large departments really going for the fuel cell. And here you see some of the cars. The Mercedes has announced they will produce fuel cell in more or less mass production 2015. Hyundai has announced that they will go for mass production in 2013 already. And you see that all these companies are coming with these fuel cells on the market. There are large programs already running. For example, Mercedes with Shell producing the hydrogen. They are doing that in California, South Korea, Hyundai, Mitsubishi, with Toyota in Japan. Next year we will have the Kyoto-Tokyo fuel cell hydrogen highway. We have all kinds of stations over there to fuel your hydrogen into your car. And you even see, for example, that's interesting to see, Honda, you can sell a solar system, an electrolyzer, a tank station and a car at Honda. So you produce your hydrogen at home. You need a large home, of course, weet je, lot of solar cells. But it is on the market. You can buy it. You see that these car manufacturers are going into selling solar and selling electrolyzers, of course. But what I want to do, if you have a fuel cell in your car and you think of a car is only used for 7% of its time, 93% of the time a car is standing somewhere, you have a 60% efficiency of your fuel cell to produce from hydrogen electricity. We are going to produce, first of all, for example, from natural gas, hydrogen with an 80% efficiency. Then we have still a 48% efficiency of producing from natural gas electricity. That's better than the electricity efficiency that we now have in our total electricity system. Of in the Netherlands it is 40%, in China it is 33%. That's what we have today. Every of these car engines has about 100 kilowatt power in the engine. If you now make a car park where we have say 500 cars times 100 kilowatt, we have a power plant of 50 megawatts. So we are producing at the gate from, first of all, gas, hydrogen, then we fuel it in the tank. So you do not need fueling stations around you. Your parking lot is your fueling station. But at the same time, we can produce with that fuel cell for the grid electricity. That's what we want to do. 50 megawatt each. And you see here a system that you have you want to have an automatic parking lot because you don't want to be there. That has another advantage because automatic parking reduces the space for parking with 1/3 because you have to drive in. You are not so good in driving as you can do it automatically, and you need to go out of your car. And most of the height of that is waste. But there was a lot of development on automatic parking lots, and that has not have entered the market because it takes too long before your car is coming. But again, with your mobile phone, with your app, but also you can detect where you are. It is much easier to do nowadays than it was 10 years ago. So automatic parking lot, there your car has to go in producing electricity. And the nice thing is you get paid for parking your car in such a parking lot because the energy company is hiring, of course, your fuel cell. And what I said, we have a main technological challenge to go because the lifetime of that fuel cell was not long enough. So we have to develop it even beyond that 200,000 kilometers because every time that you use the car, the fuel cell, you cannot drive so long. Much cheaper, because you don't have to build power plants. Look at this. This balance, you could say. At the moment, look to this system, what is going to happen. At the moment we have about 5,000 gigawatts of installed electricity production capacity in the world, producing 22,000 terawatt hours a year. And we have about 1 million cars that are only running, are used for 7% of the time. 50 kilowatts, the old cars, the present fleet has 50 kilowatts on average power. And we are buying 80 million new cars each year with 80 kilowatts on average capacity. What do we have on the road? We have 1 billion cars times 50 kilowatts. We have 50,000 gigawatts on electricity production capacity nowadays on the road, with a poor efficiency, of course. That is two times as much as the 5,000 gigawatts that we have installed in our park. Every year, we are buying 80 million new cars. Times that 80 kilowatts, every year we are buying on the road 6,400 gigawatts. More than that there is in the installed capacity in the world. If we now have our fuel cells, and here I don't have counted for the buses or the trucks or whatever, then our electricity system will be, the production system will be the car in the near future. And I have all kinds of calculations, but we go to the end. You see here what it means if you compare that with the present energy efficiencies that we have in our electricity system. 36% in the Netherlands, we have on average SD efficiency in our electricity production. When we do this with the car parks, the power plants, the cars as our power plants, we have 44%. And when we look to the transport system, I've not counted for that efficiency loss. We compare the engine, you could say, 16% at present, compared to 35% when you do that with the fuel cell. So you save a lot of energy. And we do not need power plants. We do not need fueling stations because we have that hydrogen fueled into your car at the car park. We need less refineries. There are a lot of other advantages that you can see in this system. A very distributed system. And the final step, of course, that is that you are going to use your car in a different way because the fuel cell is there. We have a lot of these offshore renewable energy production, even more than that we can use directly in our electricity grid, then you are going to convert by electrolyzers that electricity into hydrogen, and you can drive on electricity via hydrogen on the road, distances of 1,000 or 2,000 kilometers. And then your car is in that car park balancing the power. We don't have a problem with a difference in load and demand. We can balance that with the car, with the fuel cells in our car. And that's what I think the system of the future will be. Renewable and the car as our power plant. Thank you.